Hello and welcome to WION Live Broadcast. I'm Alison LaGrange from Durban, and these are the top stories of the hour. Over 1.3 million Indian teenagers vaccinated by 3 p.m. local time on the first day of vaccination drive for those aged 15 and above. Authorities say registrations are rising by the minute. UK Education Secretary Nadeem Zahawi said that the latest coronavirus data did not suggest any new restrictions would be needed in England. Pakistan's Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi downplays rows over Durand Line amid reports of Taliban removing border fencing. Qureshi says whatever little issues are there will be resolved. Amid the ongoing currency crisis, Turkey's inflation has surged to a 19-year high. This is the highest since October 2002, when inflation reached 33.45% before Erdogan's party came to power. At least one person has been killed and thousands have been temporarily displaced as heavy flooding hit Indonesia's Sumatra Island. Local administrations declare a 14-day emergency. Hello and welcome. Let's take a look at our top story. When it comes to social media platforms, free speech and the spread of misinformation are divided by an extremely thin line. Many fail to understand the difference. Sometimes even the social media platforms themselves. And Twitter has been one of the most controversial social media platforms when it comes to this. Now, the social media platform's latest move has sparked a massive storm. The Twitter account of leading U.S. virologist Dr. Robert Malone has been banned. Now, Dr. Robert Malone is the inventor of the mRNA technology, which has been used to vaccinate millions of people. But shockingly, Twitter has suspended this same scientist for spreading alleged misinformation on COVID vaccines. Now, Dr. Malone had over 500,000 followers on Twitter. He was removed after he shared a video about supposed harmful effects of the Pfizer jab. In a tweet, Dr. Malone has noted that Pfizer's six-month data showed that its COVID vaccine caused more illness than it prevents. He also pointed out the flaws in Pfizer's trial, both in design and execution. In a video, he explained the harms feared to be coming from the Pfizer mRNA vaccine for COVID-19. Twitter so far has not commented on the move. Despite being involved with the development of the mRNA technology, Dr. Malone has become an outspoken critic of mass vaccination. Both the Pfizer and Moderna jabs are built on mRNA technology, which uses genetic engineering to create antibodies. Dr. Malone, however, says that there is not enough testing in place to warrant mass vaccination. The sudden suspension of Dr. Malone's account has raised doubts about Twitter's authority and credibility. Malone's followers have slammed the social media website for silencing the voice of a top scientist and doctor without a fact check. Now, after a weekend of muted New Year's Eve celebrations, the citizens of the United States are facing the uncertainty of 2022 as the country continues to battle another COVID wave. In the latest, the Defense Secretary, Lloyd Austin, has tested positive for COVID-19. According to the statement released by the Department of Defense, Secretary Austin is exhibiting mild symptoms. Austin will remain at home, quarantined, for the next 5 days in accordance with the new guidelines. Now, last week, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention had shortened the recommended isolation period four people testing positive from 10 days to 5 days. Now, if the person infected is asymptomatic. Now, Secretary Austin also informed that he last met with President Joe Biden on the 21st of December and had tested negative that morning. As the new year begins with a massive influx of COVID-19 cases, healthcare services are already feeling the impacts. Healthcare workers have been exhausted by several surges, and now many are getting sidelined during the rapid rise of the Omicron variant, which remains the most contagious strain to have hit the United States. Amid the mounting concerns, America's top medical advisor, Dr. Anthony Fauci, has warned against more hospitalizations in the coming weeks.
Say one thing, we've got to be careful about that, because even if you have a less of a percentage of severity, when you have multi-fold more people getting infected, the net amount is you're still going to get a lot of people that are going to be needing hospitalization.
Cases are soaring. Hospitals are reeling. Fear is intensifying. And students are preparing to return to school starting this week. Now, students in the United States are set to resume in-person learning in schools which are reopening at full capacity. Masks are compulsory, and some schools are planning to vastly ramp up tests among students and staff. Meanwhile, several teachers are asking officials to utilize distance learning while the latest wave is at its peak. A small number of schools have even switched to remote learning. At least five metro area school districts will begin remote learning this week. And in Washington, D.C., public schools will remain shut until Thursday due to the winter storms. But the states like Massachusetts and New York have rejected the request from the teachers' union for remote learning. So for more on this, we have our correspondent, Susan Tehrani, joining us live from New York City. Hello to you, Susan. Now, caution by Dr. Fauci and the opening up of the schools, as an example, he says cautious, but he sees hope.
That's right. That is really the sentiment right now among healthcare professionals as well as Dr. Fauci. That the Omicron variant, despite being highly transmissible, it is sort of milder, and people are treating it hopefully as being sort of like a flu. And you know, we talk about the opening of schools, and just like anything else, it's really a highly polarized issue. And the question is, you know, people are asking whether or not it's safe to send kids to school, but then the other question on the other side of the coin is whether or not families and parents are really prepared to keep children at home for at-home learning, and whether or not they have the resources or not to really accommodate something like that with their jobs, with childcare, and with, you know, everything else that goes into that. Here in New York City, the newly elected mayor, Eric Adams, said that we have, quote unquote, already lost 2 years of education due to COVID-19, meaning that really at-home learning and remote learning is really not as effective as being in classrooms. We've had officials say that schools are the safest place to be. But on the other hand, teachers' unions have said that, you know, they prefer to stay at home. And that's something that has been very controversial, you know, the unions fighting with the government. So, you know, some of it is a play on politics. Others is personal preference for safety. But at the end of the day, I think health experts believe that, you know, Omicron is something with the current resources that are at hand can be combated without shutting down schools.
Right.
At least in
some
districts have decided to take measures. Yeah.
Absolutely. Now on Lloyd Austin being infected with the coronavirus, what do we know about his status? Can you talk to us about him declaring his status of being COVID positive and also him quarantining himself? And do we know his vaccination status?
Right, so Lloyd Austin said that the last time he met with President Joe Biden was on the 21st, basically, and that was he said about 5 or 8 days before he felt the first symptoms of COVID. He hopes that he was not transmissible. He did not go to the White House. After that, he said that he'll be quarantining for 5 days. These are the new CDC guidelines, as opposed to the former 10 days quarantine recommendations. He said that he has been vaccinated, and he also said that he's going to be carrying out his meetings virtually moving forward. Of course, the CDC said that they are going to put forth more recommendations and have more clarity on what quarantine guidelines are going to be this coming week. There had been some misunderstandings on, you know, why from the 10 days to the 5 days and how that's going to move forward. That's what, at least in the case of Lloyd Austin, he said that he's going to be quarantining for 5 days, and then we'll see what happens after that.
Right. Susan, thank you very much for being with us on this broadcast, bringing us all from the U.S. Now, tensions between Russia and Ukraine show no signs of ending. With the West and NATO involved, the two neighbors have refused to see eye to eye. In the latest, U.S. President Joe Biden spoke to his Ukrainian counterpart, Volodymyr Zelensky, and reassured him of U.S. support. Now, the call came just days after President Biden spoke to Russian President Vladimir Putin amid Moscow's border tensions with Ukraine. Briefing reporters after the call, White House spokesperson Jen Psaki said that President Biden made it clear that the U.S. and its partners will respond decisively if Russia invades Ukraine. Biden and Zelensky also discussed preparations for a series of upcoming diplomatic meetings to address the crisis. Zelensky took to Twitter and said that the two leaders discussed joint actions on keeping the peace in Europe and that Ukraine appreciated Washington's unwavering support. It's going to be a busy week of diplomacy starting next week. From the 9th of January, representatives from the U.S. and Russia are set to meet in Geneva, followed by Russia-NATO Council talks in Europe. Last week, President Biden had warned his Russian counterpart about what would happen if Moscow didn't back down. Sanctions will be imposed. The U.S. will increase its presence in Europe, and Russia will have to pay a heavy price. The Kremlin has already called these measures a colossal mistake, which could have ramifications on the already strained U.S.-Russian relationship. The U.S. and its European allies have accused Russia of threatening Ukraine with a new invasion. Some 100,000 Russian troops are gathered near the Ukraine-Russia border. While Russia denies planning any such invasion, tensions remain high, since Moscow in 2014 did exactly that, invade and annex the Crimean Peninsula. Now, Moscow has justified the troop presence as protection against the expansion of NATO, although Ukraine has not been offered membership in the military alliance. Russian President Vladimir Putin held a phone call with his Turkish counterpart, Recep Tayyip Erdogan, after tensions mounted over NATO and Turkish drones being sold to Ukraine in recent weeks. The two leaders have pledged to improve ties. Now, the Kremlin said in a statement about the leaders' phone call, Putin and Erdogan summarized the results of bilateral cooperation. The Kremlin said both the leaders confirmed the desire to further intensify the mutually beneficial partnership between Russia and Turkey, while Erdogan's office said that both sides discussed steps to improve Turkish-Russian relations and reiterated their desire to develop cooperation in all fields. The call comes as NATO member Turkey angered Moscow by supplying weapons to Ukraine. For the first time in late October, Turkish armed drones were used against Russia-backed separatists in eastern Ukraine. Putin had criticized Kiev for deploying Turkish-made drones in its conflict with pro-Moscow separatists in two eastern regions. Ankara said it cannot be blamed for Ukraine's use of the Turkish drones, also adding that if a state buys Turkish weaponry, it is no longer a Turkish product, but belongs to the country which buys it. Turkey, which has the NATO alliance's second largest army, has good ties with both Kiev and Moscow. But it has criticized Moscow's seizure of Ukraine's Crimean Peninsula and also voiced support for Ukraine's territorial integrity. Now, Russia has amassed about 100,000 troops near its border with Ukraine. In particular, Moscow wants NATO to deny membership to Ukraine and other former Soviet countries. Russia wants NATO to withdraw its forces to the positions held before the wave of eastward expansion. Moscow also demands a binding security guarantee from NATO. Turkish Foreign Minister Mevlut Cavusoglu urged Russia last week to drop one-sided demands and adopt a more constructive approach. Now, in the latest development on the rare defection story from South Korea, authorities in Seoul have now claimed that the person who crossed the heavily fortified border last week is presumed to be a North Korean who had previously defected to the South. The rare defection was confirmed by South Korea's Joint Chief of Staff after they carried out a search operation for the South Korean in the heavily fortified region. The South Korean was first detected around 9:20 p.m. local time on the eastern side of the demilitarized zone on Sunday.
어제 야간에 동부 전선 DMZ를 통해 미상 인원 1명이 월북한 상황이 있었으며 현재 합참 전투태세 검열실에서 현장 확인 중에 있습니다.
The defection was confirmed around an hour later. There are no details if the person is alive, but South Korea has sent a message to the North asking for the man's protection through a military hotline. Border crossing is illegal in South Korea. The incident comes at a time when Pyongyang has enforced strict border control due to the pandemic. In September 2020, North Korea killed a suspected South Korean defector. This was after the South Korean fisheries official was found floating in North Korean waters. The man was shot and his body burned, allegedly due to fears over coronavirus. Now, this was in line with what Seoul called North Korea's strict antivirus rules that involve shooting anyone illegally crossing the border. The two Koreas are split along the world's most heavily armed border. An estimated 2 million mines are peppered inside the demilitarized zone. It is guarded by barbed wire fences, tank traps, and combat troops on both sides. Defections through the zone are rare. At the height of their Cold War rivalry, both Koreas had sent agents and spies to each other's territory through this region. Thousands of people gathered in the streets of the Iraqi capital to mark the second anniversary of Iran's top general Qasem Soleimani's killing. Iraqis held a candlelight vigil at Baghdad airport where Soleimani and leader of Iraq's popular mobilization force, Abu Mahdi al-Mohandas, were killed in a drone strike 2 years ago. The strike was ordered by former U.S. President Donald Trump. Protesters displayed the wreckage of the car that transported Soleimani and Mohandas in their final moments. The crowd called for the expulsion of remaining American forces from Iraq.
خلال استهدافهم لرمز المقاومة الإسلامية أنه يصورون أنهم خلال استهدافهم الرموز هم راح ينهون المقاومة وبالعكس هم اليوم هاي المقاومة اليوم والمقاومين والشباب الموجودين كلهم بهم خير وبركة كلهم قادة.
The killing of Soleimani pushed Iran and the United States perilously close to a full-blown conflict. Iran has repeatedly pledged to avenge Soleimani's death. The drone attack also sparked outrage in Iraq, leading to the parliament to pass a resolution calling for the expulsion of all foreign troops from its soil. Meanwhile, in Israel, news agency Jerusalem Post has said that its website has been hacked in what it said was an apparent threat to the country. The picture reportedly showed a scene from Iran's military drill last month, in which Tehran destroyed a mock-up of Israel's nuclear reactor. The illustration showed a bullet-shaped object shooting out of a red ring, which is an apparent reference to Soleimani's iconic piece of jewelry. Now, the Iran-backed groups have been repeatedly accused of trying to hack Israeli sites in recent months. It's part of a years-long shadow war between both the countries. The threats came amid Vienna talks that aimed to revive Tehran's nuclear deal with world powers. Iran intensified its nuclear advances after the U.S. under Trump administration backed out of the agreement in 2018. Israel has long seen Iran's nuclear program as a threat and has called on the U.S. to bring in stern actions against Iran. On to other news now. Sea level rise caused by global warming is threatening a bay on the coast of Congo. Once home to an important slave trading post, the local community is worried part of their history will disappear with it. Take a look at this next report to find out more.
Luango Bay, a historical slave trade site on the west coast of the Republic of Congo, is at risk of washing away along with its important history. The bay was one of the main gateways for the Atlantic slave trade. Located in one of the country's rare rocky coastal areas, the bay is now threatened with extinction as a result of marine erosion and the degradation of the area's unique ecosystem. It is exposed to the powerful open waters and currents of the Atlantic Ocean.
Matachebo a la particularité, disons la singularité, d'être l'un des rares vestiges vivant, parce que comparativement aux autres comptoirs des esclaves sur le golfe de Guinée, les comptoirs étaient construits en matériaux durables. Mais ici, à Luango, le comptoir était construit en matériaux végétal.
Relentless marine erosion risks destroying not only the local ecosystem and the communities that depend on it, but also an important part of the colonial history, the memory of the Atlantic slave trade. From the 1500s to 1867, vessels in the Atlantic slave trade moved nearly 12.5 million African slaves from the coast of Africa to the Americas and the Caribbean. More than 2 million people were transported from the Gulf of Guinea in Luango Bay, known as the slave route. Today, the historic site has fallen into disrepair and attracts only a few tourists every year. The government is now being urged to act.
La solution, eh bien, la solution, il faut voir l'autorité. Et qui est aussi capable de comprendre son histoire, de vouloir apprendre cette histoire-là à toute génération et même aux générations présentes, pourquoi pas. Mais quand l'autorité peut-être se dise que... Parce que quand on veut aménager un site, il faut des moyens matériels et humains. Mais si les moyens matériels, ils manquent d'abord.
Mango trees grew along the route during this period. Only three of the original trees survived. To make sure that this powerful symbol of slave trade doesn't die, a project called Matachebo is cloning the remaining trees. Batota Kisala leads this initiative.
Faire de cette zone une zone d'écotourisme, dans le sens où il faut des espaces protégés, des espaces de bio pour protéger la biodiversité. Donc il faut aménager aussi des sites qui vont retracer l'histoire de cette zone.
But even those last remaining trees could vanish too if the sea claims much more of the land. Bureau Report, WION, World is One.
Egypt's Red Sea city of Hurghada witnessed a rare snowfall over the weekend. This came as the country continues to battle a wave of unstable weather. We leave you with the visuals. Thanks for watching.